everyone. Welcome to Garden Fork Radio. You're here with Eric. I wanted to thank you all. If this is your first time listening to Garden Fork, it's eclectic DIY. It's me and some of my friends talking about cooking, gardening, home repair, fixing stuff, making stuff. And today I have my friend Dave on from Clean Slate Farm. Welcome, Dave.
Hey, how you doing, Eric?
I'm good. You were posting, you have a really fun Instagram feed. It's Clean Slate Farm on Instagram.
Yep.
And so every day you're either making bread or doing this and that, but you are doing some mushroom spawn. So I emailed you, everyone. I emailed Dave and I said, let's talk about mushrooms because I want to start doing that. So here we are.
Yeah, not the funny kind, though. Just the regular kind.
Well, my backstory is I already do some foraging for mushrooms. There's a couple around here that I know they're edible. There's a lot that I don't know. I'm clearly an amateur here, guys. But my neighbor is logging part of their forest, and we go hiking through there. And cool. They leave a ton of slash. Anything smaller than like 4 inches in diameter, they just leave it on the ground. Mm-hmm. You know, because they're going to a sawmill. And my neighbor's like, yeah, take whatever you want. You know, he's a super nice guy. And so in addition to firewood, there's birch out there. There's white oak. There's red oak. There's hemlock and some beech. And I saw your pictures of you inoculating the logs. And I was like, mm-hmm. I got to do that. So here you are to tell us how to do it.
Cool. Yeah. Well, I did mine on alder, and I have two different types of mushrooms I started. Pearl oyster and shiitake. And those mushrooms grow on all. And that was my big problem is, even though I've got kind of a semi-woodlot here, I don't have logs to grow them on. And I just happened to score some alder logs one day on the way to work. This guy was chopping down wood, and I said, like, hey, I know what that is. So I stopped, and he gave me some logs. But if you've got oak and beech and birch, you've got the right logs for that. So you're golden.
Yay.
And just, there's a website, it's called Fungi Perfecti is the company name, and it's out in the Pacific Northwest. The guy's name is Paul Stamets, S-T-A-M-A-T-S, I think it is. And he's just like this brilliant mushroom guy. But he's got a company, he sells, you can buy like the little bags, plastic bags filled with sawdust, and it's inoculated. Or you can buy plugs, and the plugs are what I used.
Yeah.
And they're like furniture dowels. You've seen those, right?
Yeah, they are furniture dowels. They're birch furniture dowels. His website is fungi.com, F-U-N-G-I.com.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's where I bought ours. And it's not really hard to do. It's just, I believe it's like a year-long process. Well, it is a year-long process at least, because you've got to inoculate the logs and keep them moist and put them in the right environment. And then hopefully the next year, you end up with mushrooms. So we're waiting to see what happens this spring. So we'll see.
I was going through his site. It's got a neat chart about what kind of tree logs you have and what kind mm-hmm. of mushroom will grow well on them.
Yeah.
So that was kind of neat. And I might actually just email him with some. I'm curious. I don't think anything will grow in the hemlock, a hemlock log. But do you... Now, basically, you drill some holes and you put these plugs in the side of the log. Mm-hmm. Do you have to cover the hole with wax? I've seen that before.
Yes. And that's to help keep moisture loss in the log, because you want to keep them moist, and you don't want the moisture to lose in any cut or scar in the bark or even the end of the logs. They say to wax those just to keep moisture loss from happening. So, because you want a good moist environment.
Can you just like drip a candle onto the hole, or do you have to melt some wax? Or,
you know, if you watch the video I did on our YouTube channel,
sorry,
you'll see me, and I've got a paintbrush. Well, that's cool. I've got a paintbrush, and I'm slopping it on there, and I'm like, got wax over an open flame, and it's like the stupidest thing I've ever done. And you really don't have to.
Wax will catch on fire
very, very quickly, as I point out several times. And you probably could just use like a candle and drip it on. You should use maybe a food grade wax, though, I guess. I don't know. I used paraffin.
Well, yeah,
and then,
which is
cheese wax.
Yeah.
And then I used the cheese wax on one of them, too. So a couple of them. So, but yeah, you just have to seal them off.
And then did you have to, it said there for severe weather, you might have to put them in a garage or something, because you live upstate New York, right?
Yes.
It's cold up there.
Yeah, it gets cold. And I didn't put them, and I just left them in the woods. I'm kind of, when it comes to stuff like that, it's like, you know, nature doesn't have a garage and they grow in nature. So if nature had a garage, maybe they'd put it, it would put them in the garage. But I don't, so I kind of just run with what happens naturally. You know, it's like, we've spoken about bees before, and we're treatment-free beekeepers. And if the bees make it, they make it. You know, I don't do anything. And I feel the same way about the logs. I'm not going to be hauling. I got like 10 or 12 logs. I'm going to be dragging them around the yard and put them in the garage.
Put them in the shed.
Yeah, so I just, they're there. If it works, it works. And I think I saw some indication in the fall that we might get something. It was something I don't remember seeing on the logs before. It looked like little something or others.
Stuff so sticking we'll out.
Yeah, stuff.
My on the site here, what I also liked, that put the idea in my head that you can also inoculate tree stumps, not just tree logs.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Excuse me.
Because my neighbor, because, you know, they dropped all these trees, so there's a bunch of stumps. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, I could just, when I go hiking in the spring, just bring my cordless drill and just tap a bunch into the stumps there. And that'd be very, because that way next year on our hikes, we could just, if it rains, you know, it didn't rain last year. So if it rains, we could have some mushrooms, you know?
Yeah. And I think lion's mane grows on that well.
I think they grow here, actually. Lion's mane is M-A-N-E, lion's mane, like a horse's mane. Mm-hmm. It's a coral mushroom. And there aren't, I don't think there's any mushroom that is poisonous that looks anything like most of the coral mushrooms. So you're pretty much assured that it's a good mushroom. And they're really thick and dense, so they're easy. You can cut them into like slices and saute them. They're pretty neat.
Yeah, I've never seen one in the wild, but I think you're right. I don't think there's anything that looks like it. So if you see one, grab it.
I've seen them grow on birch here, and you can slice them off, and it's quite neat. I think I'm going to get the pearl oyster spawn, because that already grows here. You know, we get that kind of oyster mushroom. And 100 plugs is $15. That's pretty good, you know?
It's like a bargain, yeah.
I mean, 100 plugs, that's a lot of holes.
Yeah, I know. I drilled a lot of holes. Yeah.
So I was looking. Go ahead.
I'm not sure if I got 100. I got two different kinds. I'm not sure if I got 100 or 200 of each. I don't remember. But it was a lot of holes, yeah.
And there's a kind of mushroom here called turkey tail, which I think grows around here, but I did not realize was edible. But it's kind of like a fanned out. It looks a little bit like a shelf mushroom to me, but it kind of looks like a shelf mushroom with a bunch of little oyster shells or something, you know?
Yeah, it's like almost like a rainbow look, kind of, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I've seen those, but not being up on my mushrooms, it's like I'm afraid to eat one and die. Somebody told me one time, well, if you see a mouse is eating it, then it's, you know, it's good for you to eat. Well, how do you know the mouse didn't die? So
yeah.
So I just don't trust it. I know a couple, like shaggy mane, puffballs, morels, and that's what I stick to. If I see them, I take them. But
I find puffballs underwhelming. Do you like them? Or
you know, when I was a kid, my uncle Bob, who taught me a lot about foraging mushrooms and stuff like that, he would cook mushroom puffballs, and he'd slice them up into like a burger, almost kind of like seitan or the soy thing.
The meat substitute patty.
Yeah, the meat substitute patty. And they were great. I mean, we just sit there and honk down on mushrooms all afternoon. It was good. I liked them.
It's free food.
Yeah.
Another thing I want to grow is the maitakes, which right across the New York border, I'm at the Connecticut, Massachusetts, New York border, and right across the border, the soil type and the terrain changes. I don't know if it's a glacial shift or what, but maitakes grow over there, and they don't grow very much over here. But it says here that maitakes will grow in oak. Well, almost anything will grow in oak, according to this chart.
Yeah.
But the maitakes will grow in honey locust and in oak. And we have honey locust here, but they're not, they haven't felled any of those in that forest. Mm-hmm. Actually, I have honey locust right near my bees, which is really cool.
So, yeah, that's cool.
So I'm curious about the maitakes, and then I will do the pearl oysters. I had another friend of mine, Kenny Point, on, and he grows mushrooms, and he grows some called wine caps, and he does it on piles of wood chips. Have you ever heard of that?
Yeah, I have. And I think Fungi Perfect, the fungi site there, I think they've got some that grows on wood chips. And we've got a sawmill right up the road from us, and I thought, hey, that'd be pretty cool. Just go up and get a couple loads of sawdust and throw some spawn in there and see what happens. But I didn't get around to it.
Yeah, everyone, if you're looking for wood chips, at least in our town, there's a pile of them by the town garage. I think some of the wood chipper guys are allowed to drop their chips there, and the town uses them for I'm not quite sure what, but you're also allowed just to go get as many as you want. And then in New York City, we get free wood chips from Woodlawn Cemetery, which is a couple blocks from our house, and it's 500 acres of trees, so they're constantly chipping up trees that have died. And they have a big pile of them, and you just drive in the front, and you say, I'm here for wood chips, and you drive around the back, and you get them for free. You just got to haul them away.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, so check with your local cemetery.
Dead trees, dead, well, never mind. Cool. Yeah, that's neat. Yeah, the city up here, we're up near Syracuse, New York, up in the middle of the state, and they do the same thing. They've got these giant, you know, when they collect trees, they shred them up and just throw it on the side near the DPW there. And there's cars there all the time loading up. I've seen guys with like small dump trucks loading them in. It's like,
I think they're. I'm wondering if you could take a box of wood chips and put them in your basement and then put the mushroom spore on there and see what happens. I'd be curious.
I don't know. It sounds possible. I think that's what they do. Because some mushrooms need like darkness, like button mushrooms, right?
Yep.
They grow them on
in big fertilizer. Racks.
Yeah, and big racks, yeah.
Who knew? All right, so also you have backyard chickens and I don't, and we were talking about weather and stuff, and I was just like, is the chickens a new thing for you? You've been doing it for years, or?
No, they're new. We did chickens last year. We talked about it for a long time, and then we finally said, hey, let's go get chickens, which was, they're cool. They're fun. They're kind of goofy animals. But they're fun, and now you got to build a chicken coop and a chicken run, and you know the cost of our eggs just went from whatever it is in the store to like $10 a dozen because chicken coops aren't inexpensive to build. So, I used a lot of wood that I had laying around. So,
what was a big takeaway? What was something you didn't expect that you had to deal with?
If you get chicks, it takes, I can't remember what it was, like 12 weeks or 16 weeks or something like that before you start getting eggs. So like you're pumping food into them and they're fun to watch and run around and they're cute. But then it's like, okay, how about some eggs here? And then when they start laying eggs, it's like, okay, you can stop laying eggs any day now. You know, my wife takes eggs to work and just puts them out and says, hey, anybody wants eggs? Here they are. You're on your own. They're fresh off the farm, so make sure you wash them before you eat them. And if you have any problems, don't call us. So,
that's interesting. They probably should have to sign a waiver, you know?
Yeah, I thought about it. I did this whole little poster about it's this little placard to put with the eggs. And it's like, here's what you need to know about farm fresh eggs. And just like, you got to wash them. We don't wash them, you know. Make sure you store them this way, and they're good for it because eggs last forever.
Yep.
I see people like, you know, take the eggs out of the coop, put them on the counter, and leave them there for like weeks on end, and it's like, really? But apparently, it's okay. So
as far as the day to day with them, do you let them roam? Do you have to take them in at night? Are they, you know, do you have a problem with coyotes or raccoons or anything?
We don't, only because with the predators, because it's so close to the house. We're only about 25, 30 yards away from the house. And there's an automatic light. So if anything passes in front of the sensor, the light goes off and it will scare them away. So that's not been a problem for us. Predators hasn't been a problem. And during the summer, we're just getting to the point where we let them wander around if we're in the yard. And they seem to find like a spot and just like go to town. And then the next day they'll find another spot and go to town.
How do they know it's time to go back in the coop?
They just do. It's weird. They it starts getting dusk out and you look out and it's like, hey, the chickens are back in the coop. That's pretty neat. And then you go out and close them up.
Now, I do know from my neighbors that chickens will stop laying eggs in the winter because of the length of the day. The daylight is shorter. Mm-hmm. So do you put a light in the coop to keep them laying?
Well, we're total chicken noobs here. So because it gets so cold up here, like you mentioned, I put a water heater in there and a light bulb in there. And it's an LED light because I didn't want any extraneous heat that I didn't really need in there. And we set it up on a timer to give them extra light. But I've since read that there's only so many eggs in a chicken. And if you force them to lay during winter, they're going to lay fewer. Their laying lifetime will be shorter. So now I'm wondering, I don't know if I should do that. And plus, we got a lot of eggs. So I'll probably disconnect the light.
Interesting.
But yeah, we did it. And we've got four chickens. We're averaging anywhere from 2 to 4 eggs a day. And we've got a lot of eggs. Want some eggs? I'll send some down.
Yeah. My neighbors, it's funny because two different neighbors are like, I have too many eggs. I'm like, okay. So I give them raw to the dogs. They seem to really like it. So,
yeah, I didn't think about that. Yeah, we've got a dog. You can put some in the waffle. I'll send some down. You can put them in the waffles, which that waffle recipe looked great, by the way.
It was really fun to make. It was kind of one of those videos that got a lot of conversation going, which is fun. And I don't want everyone to think that I have pasta and waffles every day. But I just think, you know, if we're going to, let's be a little decadent and make a video about it, you know, because the everyday is kind of boring. We basically eat salad, you know.
That's what we do. Salad and chicken.
During the week, we have salad and beans. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah, we're the same way.
Have you grown any meat chickens?
No, we haven't. I, you know, people do that. And there's that whole homesteading thing where it's like meat chickens, meat rabbits. And when I was a kid growing up, you know, we grew meat ducks and meat chickens, or my uncle or my grandmother did. And I kind of lost the taste for killing things when I was about 16 or 17 years old.
Yeah.
So I don't hunt anymore. And I don't know if I could kill the chicken.
All right.
So.
Well, let's segue away from that then.
Like my friend said, never name your food.
We were also talking about your hoop houses or low tunnels, and how's that going?
That's going great. I like your design, because you staple yours to like a 2x4 or something, right?
Yep.
Yeah. See, I don't. I've got the hoops to go stuck in the ground, and then I secure the plastic over that, and it generally holds up the wind. But this, a few weeks ago, we had some wind that got up to like 40-mile-an-hour gusts, and the next morning I looked out and all the plastic was blown off, and all my little clips were gone. It didn't seem to hurt the garden, but I think I'm going to switch over to your system. I like yours better.
Yeah, I had some salad greens in there for the fall, and they're all toast. I mean, they're not growing anymore. They might restart regrowing. I know the kale will come back, but some of the other stuff. And I think some people, judging from the comments about the videos, it's like, oh, we'd like to get an update on your hoop houses. And I'm like, well, there's nothing there, but I guess maybe I should show them that, because dispel people the notion that in the northern United States you can grow. Well, you might be able to. I mean, the Four Season Gardener guy, Elliot Coleman, seems to be able to do it, but it's a lot of work.
Yeah. Do you know Nikki Jabor in Canada? That woman just amazes me. She's growing stuff like crazy. And then there's another woman down in Pennsylvania. I think she's zone 5 as well. Might be zone 4, but she's got a greenhouse and low tunnels, and she's constantly, her name is Sherry. I can't remember her last name, Fisher or something like that, I think it is. And she's growing stuff, and it just like blows me away, because she's eating like fresh salads, and she's got Brussels sprouts. She goes out and picks a few Brussels sprouts for dinner every night.
Does she have a website or a book?
No, she's just on Facebook, and she's on Instagram. I'll try to find it and email you her address, but you should follow her because she's really good. She's like the impatient gardener.
Yeah.
Lady there.
Erin, yeah.
Yeah, Erin. Sherry's kind of like Erin. It's like, oh my God, when I grow up, I want to be Sherry and Erin.
Just brilliant, you know?
Aren't they?
Yeah, Nikki was on the podcast. I'll link to that. She was on a couple of years ago.
That's right. That's where I first heard of her, yeah.
See, I make everyone famous.
You're just the trendsetter, Eric. Just like...
the trendsetter in hoop houses.
Yeah, that and 250 will get you a cup of coffee.
Yeah. So to tie all this together, the last thing we'll talk about is our weather stations. We have the same weather station, and you actually use it in an extended way, and you're monitoring the temperatures of your coop and of your low tunnels. Is that working out well?
Yes. It's that's what I like to be able to tell what the temperature is in the coop with a remote sensor, because the weather stations we have can monitor, and there's a little smart hub thing that transmits that data out to the company. It's Accurite, and you can monitor an additional couple of sensors. So I put one in the chicken coop, so I know what the temperature is in the chicken coop, and one in the low tunnels, in one of the low tunnels, so I can see what the temperatures are in there. And not that I could do anything about the temperature in the chicken coop, because I don't want to put anything that might start the coop on fire
right
in there. But at least I know what's going on. My friend laughed at me. She goes, really? You're telling me what the temperature is in the chicken coops? And it's like, well, I'm kind of geeky like that.
What with the low tunnels, I mean, what's the variant? I mean, what are the highs and lows?
On a sunny day, if it's like now, it's like 25 degrees out. And when the sun comes up, even though it's overcast today, the temperature will rise in that. Well, hang on, let me pull up the app. I'll be able to tell in a second. But the temperature will rise in that, and it'll be on an overcast day. It's 27 degrees out now. The low tunnels are at 35.
That's at 10 o'clock in the morning.
Right. Now, the temperature will drop down. It never goes below what the outside temperature is, and sometimes it will hover just slightly above that because the ground is being warmed during the day.
Yeah, because I know at night they just freeze again, you know? So I wonder if we did like a double tunnel, because the Elliott Coleman essentially does that up in, is he in Vermont?
Yeah, he's got the giant, the high houses or high tops or
right,
something.
Right, he's got a walk-in high tunnel, yeah.
Right, and then they put them inside the low tunnels inside of that, and that adds like another zone or two.
Plus, he's got people there 24/7. I think. So.
Yeah, I know. And plus, I'm someday I'll have a greenhouse, but I don't think I'm going to go to that extreme. I'm just
surrounded by trees, so you know the sun is out right now. By 2 o'clock, it's gone in the winter here. Mm-hmm. So. But anyway, are you doing any? Are you going to do any maple syrup?
You know, I saw your evaporator thing, and it's like, oh man, I should do maple syrup. And then I start thinking about, oh man, that's a lot of work. Because I've seen you're like out there like hours on end feeding that fire, right?
It's easier than bees, I'll tell you that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I don't know. I'd like to try it someday, but I don't know if I'm, because right now I'm, you know, between the bees and the garden and. Yeah, you know, I'm getting back into bread making again, and I don't know if I have the time for that. And plus, we have so many people around here that just do terrific maple syrup. It's almost kind of like, why?
All right. Just thought I'd put that idea in your head. You can do it with a turkey deep fryer, you know, and you don't have to stand over it. You could just walk away from it. So.
Well, the first year we were in the house, it's not the right kind of maple, but there's a maple right outside the house here. It's an old silver maple, and we tapped that, and we got like 3 gallons of syrup or something, 3 gallons of sap, and we boiled that down in the house, which would you're don't ever do that.
So you took the paint off your kitchen walls?
Well, I looked around, it's like, oh my God, this is not good. So I moved it outside onto the grill. And it tasted really, really good. But I thought, oh my God, this is like, I went through like 2 canisters of propane. And
yeah, there's a lot of BTUs. That's why I burn the pallets. So yeah. They're free.
Yeah, and cool. They're made of oak, so it's long, hard-burning stuff, right?
You know, it's a bunch of different kinds of wood, but lately I've been getting oak in the palates, and which I think is very interesting. So anyway, well, I completely forgot to introduce you as you having a YouTube channel as well. It's called Clean Slate Farm at YouTube.
It's 1215 Clean Slate.
All right.
I don't know why we didn't. We should have Clean Slate Farm, but
I'll put that in the notes here. Here, I'll type while we talk. And then on Instagram, you're Clean Slate Farm.
Yep.
Which I like because it's the day-to-day. Like the other day, you walked people through your bread baking process, which was really simple. But just, you know, it took a day or two, but it was just kind of nice. And it was like, I was like, oh, this guy knows what he's talking about, unlike me.
No, unlike me. No, I just, I'm into fermenting. I started fermenting stuff a couple of years ago. And basically so much of the food we eat regularly is fermented anyway. Breads, beer, you know, sauerkrauts, pickles. And it's all just riffs on a theme. And bread is just so simple. I just did a sourdough starter a few days ago, 4 or 5 days ago. It's, you add warm water and flour and let it sit out for a few days. And every once in a while, you just mix it up and change it. And after 5 days, I got this really incredible smelling sourdough starter. And so this afternoon, I'll probably bake some bread from that and see what it comes out like. But it's simple. And it's, you know, there's so many good books on it. It's like you've done the... What, you up to like 50 million videos on your channel or something? But you've done the bread.
The no-need bread I like.
The no-need bread, yeah. And that's simple. I mean, that's like falling off a log simple. Sourdoughs are a little bit more complicated than that. But it's easy stuff, and it's such delicious food, as you know.
It all works.
Yeah.
Well, cool. Well, thanks for taking the time, sir. I know we'll have more mushroom questions, but now I've been thinking about this for the past 2 days. And I was out hiking every morning, and I got my tree identification book out, and I figured out the red oak and the white oak, and I'm like, okay. Yep. And I'm marking them. I haven't marked them physically, but in my brain, I'm like, okay, well, that one's on that. This is where the trail goes up the hill, and that's where the birch logs are laying. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to go in there with my quad and my chainsaw and trailer and cut like 3 foot lengths and bring it back to the house here, and then in spring I will drill the holes and inoculate them. So
yeah, check on the website, because you have to drill them as soon as you possibly can. You don't want them to sit too long before drilling them,
right? So, it said not to do it in the winter though, so
okay.
It said wait till spring, so I mean the logs are laying, so the whole idea is that you inoculate the log before it is taken over by some other kind of fungus.
Right, so get them out of the woods then, yeah.
Yeah. All right, cool. Thank you, sir.
Hey, Eric, thanks for calling. Appreciate it.